Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. You declare your almighty power chiefly in showing mercy and pity. Grant us the fullness of your grace, that we, running to obtain your promises, may become partakers of your heavenly treasure. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Amen.
First lesson is from Jeremiah 32. The word that came to Jeremiah from the Lord in the 10th year of King Zedekiah of Judah, which was the 18th year of Nebuchadnezzar. At that time, the army of the king of Babylon was besieging Jerusalem, and the prophet Jeremiah was confined in the court of the guard that was in the palace of the king of Judah, where King Zedekiah of Judah had confined him. Jeremiah said, "The word of the Lord came to me. Hanamel, king of your son Shalom, is going to come to you and say, 'Buy my field that is at Anathoth, for the right of redemption by purchase is yours.' Then my cousin Hanamel came to me in the court of the guard in accordance with the word of the Lord and said to me, 'Buy my field that is at Anathoth in the land of Benjamin, for the right of possession and redemption is yours. Buy it for yourself.' Then I knew that this was the word of the Lord, and I bought the field at Anathoth from my cousin Hanamel and weighed out the money to him, 17 shekels of silver. I signed the deed, sealed it, got witnesses, and weighed the money on scales. Then I took the sealed deed of purchase containing the terms and conditions and the open copy, and I gave the deed of purchase to Baruch, son of Neriah, son of Maaseiah, in the presence of my cousin Hanamel, in the presence of the witnesses who signed the deed of purchase, and in the presence of all the Judeans who were sitting in the court of the guard. In their presence I charged Baruch, saying, 'This says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, take these deeds, both this sealed deed of purchase and this open deed, and put them in an earthenware jar, in order that they may last for a long time. For thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, houses and fields and vineyards shall again be bought in this land.' The word of the Lord.
In the shelter of the Most High abides under the shadow of the Almighty. He shall say to the Lord, "You are my refuge and my stronghold.
My God, in whom I trust."
He shall deliver you from the snare of the hunter.
And from the deadly pestilence.
He shall cover you with his pinions, and you shall find refuge under his wings.
His faithfulness shall be a shield from the hunter.
You shall not be afraid of any terror by night, of the plague that stalks in the darkness, because he is bound to me in love, therefore will I deliver him. He shall call upon me, and I will answer him. With long life will I satisfy him.
Take nothing out of it. But if we have food and clothing, we will be content with these. But those who want to be rich fall into temptation and are trapped by many senseless and harmful desires that plunge people into ruin and destruction. For the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil, and in their eagerness to be rich, some have wandered away from the faith and pierced themselves with many pains. But as for you, man of God, shun all this. Pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, endurance, gentleness. Fight the good fight of the faith. Take hold of the eternal life to which you were called and for which you made the good confession in the presence of many witnesses. In the presence of God, who gives life to all things, and of Christ Jesus, who in his testimony before Pontius Pilate made the good confession. I charge you to keep the commandment without spot or blame, until the manifestation of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he will bring about at the right time. He who is the blessed and only sovereign, the King of kings and Lord of lords, it is he alone who has immortality and dwells in unapproachable light, whom no one has ever seen or can see. To him be honor and eternal dominion. Amen. As for those who in the present age are rich, command them not to be haughty, or to set their hopes on the uncertainty of riches, but rather on God, who richly provides us with everything for our enjoyment. They are to do good, to be rich in good works, generous and ready to share, thus storing up for themselves the treasure of a good foundation for the future, so that they may take hold of the life that really is life. The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke. Jesus said to the Pharisees, "There was a rich man who was dressed in purple and fine linen, and who feasted sumptuously every day. And at his gate lay a poor man named Lazarus, covered in sores, who longed to satisfy his hunger with what fell from the rich man's table. Even the dogs would come and lick his sores. The poor man died and was carried away by angels to be with Abraham. The rich man also died and was buried. In Hades, where he was being tormented, he looked up and saw Abraham far away with Lazarus by his side. He called out, 'Father Abraham, have mercy on me, and send Lazarus to dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am in agony in these flames.' But Abraham said, 'Child, remember that during your lifetime you received your good things, and Lazarus in like manner evil things, but now he is comforted here, and you are in agony. Besides all this, between you and us a great chasm has been fixed, so that those who might want to pass from here to you cannot do so, and no one can cross from there to us.' He said, 'Then, Father, I beg you to send him to my father's house, for I have five brothers, that he may warn them, so that they will not also come into this place of torment.' Abraham replied, 'They have Moses and the prophets. They should listen to them.' He said, 'No, Father Abraham, but if someone goes to them from the dead, they will repent.' He said to him, 'If they do not listen to Moses and the prophets, neither will they be convinced, even if someone rises from the dead.'" The Gospel of the Lord. Early this past week, we had a vestry meeting. Our vestry is a group of elected lay leaders here in this church. And we had reviewed the financial report, which we do every month, about income and expenses and how much money we had in our checking account and so forth. And so we had finished the financial report, and I said, "Well, I'm preaching about money on Sunday." And a vestry member quickly said, "Oh, I won't be there on Sunday." And then another vestry member said, "I'm not going to be there either." And then oddly, about three more vestry members said, "I'm not going to be there either." Apparently, there was an epidemic of vestry members who did not want to hear a sermon about money. I'm sure they had other reasons why they couldn't be here today. Perhaps if you knew I was going to be preaching about money, you would have stayed in bed this morning too. But I hope there's something in this sermon, in this set of scripture readings we have had today, that speaks to you and speaks a helpful message. So Jesus is, in the gospel reading today, shares a parable. And he teaches often in parables, these stories about ordinary people that convey a spiritual truth. And this particular parable is not one of our favorites. It's not one that many people would ever say, "I love that scripture passage. I love that story Jesus tells about the rich man and Lazarus." It's not one of the first ones we're quick to teach our children in Sunday school. But it is important. And it's important for us to think about today. Now, I want to quickly review the story. You just heard it, but I want to go through it again quickly. So there are two main players in the gospel parable, a rich man and a poor man. The poor man has a name. His name is Lazarus, and we don't know the rich man's name, but they lived close together. The rich man lived inside a fenced area, and the poor man lay outside the rich man's gate. And we know that every day the rich man feasted sumptuously, and the poor man longed for even a crumb that the rich man would share with him. And he did not share even a crumb. And they both die. The rich man goes to Hades. The poor man is raised and goes to paradise with Father Abraham. And the rich man in earthly life is now miserable and wants his condition changed. He calls out, wants to be saved from his suffering. And he said, if you could just send Lazarus to cool my tongue. But that can't happen. If you could just send Lazarus to warn my family so that they don't end up here. That can't happen. They wouldn't listen to him anyway. It's a simple story, but it's hard to hear. The truth in it is so hard to hear. Now, in parables, Jesus teaches in parables. They usually involve people. And we try to find ourselves in the parable in some ways, if we can. The parable is about other people, but the parable is also about us. And so when we hear a parable, we try to figure out, where am I in the story? What is God saying to me in this story? What is the point Jesus is trying to make in this story that should apply to my life? And this one is hard. So when we hear the parable, we immediately connect with Lazarus, right? Because we're compassionate people. We have a heart. And so we say, oh, poor Lazarus, what an awful life he lived. He was poor. He was miserable every day of his life. He was trapped in a life that couldn't find any way to improve itself, or so we assume. Trapped in a cycle of poverty. And then we think about the rich man. We don't really know that much about him, except that he had a lot of money and he lived a good life. We don't know, in fact, if he was an evil man. We don't know, in fact, if he ever mistreated Lazarus. Having money in itself is not a bad thing. But we learned in our epistle reading that was just before the gospel story that the love of money is dangerous and can lead us in all kinds of bad ways. Money itself is not bad. And we don't really know how the rich man acquired his money. Maybe he worked day and night all his life, worked hard to earn that money. And we don't know about Lazarus. Maybe at some point he had some money and wasted it. So we could stretch and have a little sympathy for the rich man, even. What's the story about? What's the spiritual truth here? In the story, the rich man is condemned for the choices he made in his life. The rich man could not see the poor man, even though he walked past him every day of his life. It is a parable about money, but it's not just about money. It's not just about the economy. It's a story about the heart and how we live our lives in response to a generous God who has given us everything. So how do we find ourselves in the parable?
If we look again at the rich man and the poor man and the differences between the two of them, the poor man is so downtrodden, so beaten down by the world, by society, by the people that knew him, by his circumstances, by his trapped nature. Like most people in extreme poverty, he was probably unable to even imagine that he was made in the image of God. What would that life be like? To be so beaten down that you could not even imagine that there's something in you that reflected the nature of God. On the other side of that extreme, we look at the rich man and his enormous wealth and all of his possessions and all of the ways in which those things that he owned separated him from the rest of the world. His possessions made others even invisible. How hard in that condition would it be for a rich man to see the image of God in someone who is so completely different? And therein lies the problem. One can't imagine that he's made in the image of God. One cannot see the other as made in the image of God. In the story, besides the character, there's also some things in the story that we need to take note of. The rich man lives inside a fenced area with a gate. He's protected from the world. His person is protected. His possessions are protected. He doesn't mix with the world, if you will. That fence and that gate keeps him contained, defines him in some way, keeps him separated. If we look at the parable and we try to find ourselves in it, we're going to have a hard time because most all of us, or perhaps completely all of us, would say, we've never been that poor and we've never been that rich. And where are we in the story? But I'll guarantee you, we all have our fences. We all have ways in which we build fences around ourselves, our lives, our faith, our worldview, things that define us for ourselves and keep us safe, keep us separated from others. And sometimes, I'll even grant, those fences may be necessary. If we're worried about our safety for some reason, as sometimes we are. But we have fences, metaphorically, in our lives that probably don't need to be there. Boundaries that we have added to our lives that don't really need to be there, that don't serve us well, that don't really help us deep down to live a Christian life. And what would those fences be? One of them would be our tendency to stay busy all the time. I'm just continually blown away about how fast the world is moving, how many things we have on our calendars each day, the number of commitments we have, the stress that we add to our lives because of the things that we think we have to do every day. And our busy lives are something that we can idolize just as much as the rich man idolized his money. And our busyness, our running to do things in our lives, can separate us from other people. How on earth could we have quality time with the people we know and love if we're constantly chasing after something else, constantly doing something else? What other fences do we have? Politics. Politics divides us, and we live in a world where politics is so completely divisive now and so dangerous How on earth can we see someone with different political views as someone we'd want to spend time with? What kind of fence is that? We certainly have economic divides. We're not as divided as the rich man and the poor man in the parable, but there are economic divides in our world. We are not all in the same place. There will always be people who have much more money than we do and people who have far less money than we do. And our station in life is a fence. Our habits keep us separated from others. The way we live our lives, the decisions we make, even technology now, with its promise to help us stay connected to people, can actually distance us from people. The communication we have with people now can be far less meaningful than the person-to-person, face-to-face, close enough to touch communication. Our social media world that we live in is not the real world. We can't be with people that we love in the same place at the same time because we're falling into the trap of technology. What's that doing to us? Fences. All that we know and understand about what it means to be a Christian, all the stories that we've heard, all the sermons that we've heard, all the scripture that we've read, reinforces one simple thing that we all would know and understand, is that we are made to love. We're made to love. And our great commandment that we reaffirm is that we're to love God with our whole heart, and we're to love our neighbors as ourselves. So many of Jesus' teachings and commandments and parables even reinforce this idea that we are to give ourselves away. We're not to work our whole life to accumulate things for ourselves. We're to work our whole lives in order to share it, to understand how God has blessed us, to understand how God can be using us day after day after day to make the world better, to share God's love, to know what God has done for us, and to be able to reach out and share what we have with others to make the world a better place. So where do we find ourselves in the parable? We certainly don't want to be like the rich man who can't see other people. Our life and faith needs to help us see other people as God sees them. Not whether or not they're like us, not whether or not they believe like us or vote like us or live in a home like us, but how can we love them? How can we find Christ in another person? So I'll just wrap up my sermon with one little takeaway thing for you to think about. If you could improve the life of one other person in some way with the resources that you already have, wouldn't you do it? If you could improve the life of one other person with the resources that you already have, wouldn't you do it? With the Holy Spirit and the power of the Holy Spirit and the love of God in your heart, we can all do it, and we should all do it. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Thank you. the church may truly and humbly serve you. We pray for all bishops, priests, and deacons. We pray for all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world. Give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake. Have compassion on those who suffer from any grief or trouble. Give to the departed eternal rest. We praise you for your saints who have entered into joy. Let us pray for our own needs and those of others.
Lord, hear the prayers of your people and what we have asked faithfully. Grant that we may obtain effectually to the glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways for the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Good morning and welcome to Trinity Church. We're delighted that you're here with us. We hope that if you are visiting for the first time, that you'll fill out a visitor's card and place it in the offering plate. Or there's maybe a pad in front of you that you can sign that pad to let us know that you're here today. And we hope you'll stay for a time of fellowship on the front lawn of the church. Today at 1 o'clock, we will have a blessing of the animals. So if you have a wonderful little pet at home that it means so much to you, we invite you to bring them back up here at 1 o'clock. You'll have time to go home and eat a quick sandwich and then bring up your dog or your cat or whomever you have at home. And we'll have a short but very fun and exciting outdoor worship where we give thanks to God for our special pets and bless them. So that's today at 1 o'clock. We had previously advertised it as 2, but it's an hour earlier. It's at 1 o'clock, so please be aware of the time change. I want to remind you that every Wednesday we have a Bible study at 10 o'clock in the parlor. Every Wednesday at 11:30 we have a service in the chapel of Holy Eucharist and healing prayers. And every Wednesday we have evening prayer at 5:30. So please join us for one of those if you can. It's a wonderful way to connect with God and your church family midweek. And so I invite you to do that. Do you have an announcement, Elliot? Come on up, and then Father Andy.
Good morning. Next Sunday night, calling all adults, a few maybe in their second childhood, but John and Margaret Page have graciously invited all the adults to an evening of just enjoyment and entertainment at their house. have, it will be at 6 o'clock. Call the church office and let them know if you're coming. We hope you will. And just prepare your favorite hors d'oeuvre to bring along with you. There will be parking on Hilton Avenue. There will be a policeman there because it is Hilton Avenue to sort of direct and guide you. But anyway, do come. It'll be a wonderful time. John and Margaret are wonderful hosts. So hope to see you there.
Just very quickly, it was brought to my attention that a parishioner has lost an engagement ring in the grass and the stone out front of the church. So if anyone happens to find that or see it, if you could please call the church office or bring it into the church office, and we'll do our best to connect it to the person who lost it. Thank you.
And we can have a very nice search party after the meeting. Well, then loves Christ helped us and gave himself for us an offering and sacrifice.
Thank you.
let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. For you are the source of light and life. You made us in your image and called us to new life in Jesus Christ our Lord. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. And when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you and your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took a cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit, to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen." Hallelujah. Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast.
The gifts of God for the people of God, take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. The blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. Amen.